Good morning. Was I on? Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Providence Church. I'm Dan Freemyer, senior pastor, and I don't see anybody who probably doesn't know that already, so I didn't need to say that. It is chilly. I washed my hands right before I came in here, and they are still freezing cold because that water was very cold. But I'm thrilled that everyone has braved the chilly weather, but it's beautiful weather, and we are grateful for it. I do have a couple of announcements for you this morning. One, you have probably noticed in your worship guide this extra card, which is our pledge card for 2022. I hope if you have not already taken the opportunity to do so, that you'll prayerfully consider what gifts and tithes you plan to give to the church this year, and you will indicate that to us. It is very helpful for us in knowing that and keeping track of that throughout the year. You should have received an email yesterday with an alternative to the printed cards for you to submit that online. You can choose either. You can come in and tell Renee in person. You can, write it on the front of your house and take a picture and Snapchat that to us. However you would like to get us your pledge for this year, we will be happy to receive it. And I said I had a couple of announcements, but I think that might be it. So now as we proceed further into worship, know that Christ is with you.
Thank you. Please join me in reading our call to worship. O God, by your Spirit, now give us a vision. Where background and culture won't lead to division. God, now to your great celebration.
Today's reading is 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not, and if I hand over nothing, love is patient. Love is kind. Love is envious. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
calling people out on a Sunday morning is not something I do too often, but there are two families I'd like to call out. Two folks sitting over here are new grandparents, Walter and Michelle Hyatt. Do we have names for grandparent names? M and Daddy something. Well, we are excited for the Hyatt family, for the Grimes, for Josh and Allie, and Laurel is home, and Weston is hopefully coming home this week, so that is super exciting, and we really do celebrate with y'all. And I'm guessing this might be the last time we see somebody else in church this morning who is looking for the same kind of celebration. Stacy, you want to... This week, next week? Okay, so by this time next week, we will have a baby Cora to celebrate. Yeah! And two very excited big brothers. I love it. We celebrate with y'all and pray for a good week and a safe and healthy and... swift, perhaps, delivery. Let's go to God in prayer as a family. God, we're in that liminal space again, the time between time. We wrapped up Advent and Christmas, and now we're reading about Jesus' ministry on earth. It's a little taste of what the church calls ordinary time, but it feels anything but. Today's gospel lesson will give a really big hint of the path Jesus is taking. He's making people angry and getting himself into all kinds of trouble. And we know what's ahead of him. Lent is just around the corner, and we'll begin to prepare ourselves for a season of sacrifice. But today's gospel reading is tempered by a very familiar text from 1 Corinthians. It's often referred to as the love chapter. And how fitting for us to remember the central theme of the gospel and of Jesus' life and death. And now faith, hope, and love abide, but the greatest of these is love. Grant us courage, O God, to join Jesus on his journey, offering radical love to those who might never expect it or receive it otherwise. Even when we are faced with hardship or rejection because of it, help us to be voices of acceptance and grace. Help us to receive the love you offer to us, the love that reminds us that we are cherished and enough. Help us to pay attention that we might recognize your love at work within us and around us. And help us to see others' needs that we might offer your gracious love and in so doing join your work in this world. Grant us wisdom and courage that we might serve you faithfully. Amen.
Today's reading is from Luke 4, 21 through 30. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you do in Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly, I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them except to a widow in Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophets Elijah, and none of them were cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up and drove him out of the town and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Join me up front, please. So I wanted to show you something that I made. Does it look like anything familiar to you?
We're celebrating Valentine's Day.
Valentine's Day is coming up. It's my Valentine's box, like for swapping cards. But what did I forget? Well, I forgot my name. What else did I forget?
My birthday is the day after Valentine's Day.
Congrats. What's going to make it hard for people to put a card in? I forgot the hole. It's been a while, obviously. But I wanted to share this with you because I want to talk about love. And Valentine's Day is a time where we share lots of love for our classmates and our teachers and our family. And I like it because it's kind of simple and we want to try to include everybody. I know when I was a teacher, I would say, you better have everybody. You know, you have to have a card for everybody. I was really strict about that. And what I love about Valentine's Day now is you don't just get cards, right? You get goodies, which I'll share with y'all later. I have plenty. And I think that's kind of fun and yummy. And I love getting goodies. Do you, Palmer? Yeah. So Valentine's Day is a real simple way for us to express love to friends and love to family. But there's some deeper loves that you guys express. And I wanted to have you guys talk about those a little bit. What kind of love is this? You can just say it.
Animal love or pet love.
Loving, kind. It's a kind love and it's taking... Animals really, they give back to us a lot because they love us so much. But they need help, right? They can't... Well, I guess some of them can get their own food, but...
And helping them, like if they're just born, like helping them, like, walk or something, or, like eat.
Yeah, teach them how to use the bathroom, all that stuff. So, care for animals is a little bit deeper love than Valentine's Day. What about this picture? Uh-huh. What kind of, who do you think this is on this picture? Just maybe else? Maybe a little girl and her mom.
Or a doctor.
Could be. Mm-hmm. So that's even a little bit deeper love, people caring for other people. Well, let me tell you something. The way that we know how to love each other is just a tiny, tiny hint of what God's love is like. We'll never really get it while we're here on earth, but God loves us so, so, so much more than this. And so I hope when you're afraid or when you've just had a crummy day that you can remember how much God loves you. I think probably the closest thing I know about it is maybe seeing a newborn baby, because that is pretty special. And I know some of you are about to experience that, and that's super special. Not yet.
Because I'm not a girl.
But there, you know what? There might be one in your neighborhood soon that you can enjoy. And I don't, I mean, it's very special if it's in your family, but any newborn baby, I'm pretty excited. All right. Let's say a quick prayer before our music. Dear God, thank you for all the ways that we experience love. And even though it's just a glimmer of your love for us, help us to share the love that we know how to share with the people in our lives. Amen.
Thank you.
Excuse me, I've been coughing all week. I tested, so I know it's not COVID, but something else has decided to live in my throat, and we'll try to keep it down there this morning. So, this is a book entitled The True Church and Her Enemies by John Lee Presser. Now, Reverend Presser's granddaughter, Carmen Lee Pirtle, passed on the middle name from John Lee that she received from John Lee Presser to her youngest son, Daniel Lee Freemyer. Now, Diane and I have since given that name to our daughter, Elizabeth Lee Freemyer. Now, I never met my great-grandfather Presser, since he died before I was born, even though he did live to 91. But I've heard stories. He was a rural missionary Baptist pastor in the early 20th century who most assuredly would have preached against the evils of alcohol, dancing, and gambling on Sunday mornings, but who also happened to enjoy playing the fiddle for square dances on Friday nights. Grandpa Presser studied at Southern Baptist Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky, the same institution where I would study 70 years later. He finished his coursework, but when it came time to submit a thesis to graduate, he decided not to. According to family legend, he wanted the education, but he didn't want the degree. You see, he feared that with the degree, he would be forced to move to a big city pulpit, and that's not what he wanted. He wanted to stay as a small town pastor. So as the story goes, sometime later, one of his friends submitted to the seminary, without his knowledge, one of the books that my great-grandfather had written, perhaps even this one, and his degree was eventually conferred. Now, I'm sure you've been waiting on bated breath with great suspense to find out, since you heard the title of this book, which is the true church and who exactly are her enemies. Well, I won't leave you in suspense any longer, as my great-grandfather didn't leave his readers in suspense, since he pinned this in the preface to the book. The author passes no judgment on the religion of any Protestant. He firmly believes that there are thousands of excellent Christians among Protestant bodies, but he affirms and seeks to prove, both from scripture, history, and persecution, that missionary Baptist churches are the only true New Testament churches on the face of the earth, and that they have been in existence from the days of the apostles to the present. Yeah, pretty good stuff, huh? I attempted to write a paper on this book while I was in seminary, and I gave up. It was too much. And it really comes as no great surprise that my great-grandfather would espouse this radical exclusivism, since it was prevalent among many Baptists in his day. Indeed, there are still some Baptists today, granted comparatively few, but still some who hold strongly to this landmarkist belief that there is a trail of blood that leads directly from Jesus Christ and the apostles through history to these particular Baptist churches and only to these churches, making all other forms of liturgical practice invalid. Now, I'd be surprised if there are any landmarkists among Providence's ranks today. Indeed, with so many different traditions represented here, I'm a little surprised sometimes when I find out somebody has a Baptist background. But lest we be quick to judge my great-grandfather and these others for their exclusivism, We must admit that most of us are guilty of thinking that Jesus was like us. As Lutheran pastor Katie Hines Shaw puts it, we know from history that Jesus was a Middle Eastern Jew, but that doesn't usually change the image in our heads and in our hearts. The joke is that somehow we imagine that Jesus was like us, and because he was like us, he liked us. That's how Jesus can become, say, a light-skinned, blue-eyed Christian American who votes the way we do, or at least roots for our favorite football team. And we aren't alone. This idea that Jesus is our guy goes all the way back to the first Christians, to the first disciples, to the people who knew Jesus before anyone did, the people of Nazareth. Now, last week, we read about the time that Jesus stood in front of the synagogue and read from the Isaiah scroll and followed it up by saying, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." And then today, we heard the next part of the story where all that were present spoke well of him and were amazed at the glorious words that came from his mouth. So they all revel in the good news. After all, this one that they've heard has been doing miracles for others is one of their own. Joseph's son, the carpenter's son, who grew up just down the street. So if he's been doing all these wonderful things for all those other people, how much better is he going to do for us? Again, according to Pastor Hines Shaw, the Jews of Nazareth aren't xenophobes. They don't wish ill on their neighbors. They simply believe what we all believe, that these promises, this good news, these miracles are primarily and maybe even exclusively for us. They marvel how that it's a local boy who's so smart and well-spoken, and now he's come home to give us what is rightfully ours. Until he keeps speaking, of course. Because once they hear the rest of what he has to say, they want to throw him off a cliff. So much for that happy local boy makes good homecoming. But what could he have said that would make them so angry? He simply reminds them of specific examples in their history of times when God loves and cares for everyone else as much as them. "You remember Elijah, don't you?" Jesus asks. Of course they do. Elijah's their hero, one of the greatest prophets. And Jesus reminds them that during the great famine, Elijah didn't feed anyone from Nazareth, or even anyone from Jerusalem. But Elijah did make sure that there was a Lebanese woman who was well fed. And then Jesus reminds them about when Elisha, their other venerated prophetic hero, Elisha didn't heal any of the Jewish lepers. No, he only healed Naaman, the Syrian. Naaman, who was not only a foreigner, but Naaman, who was the commander of the enemy's army. Elisha, and by extension God, cared more about some foreign enemy than about our own neighbors and kin who were afflicted with the same disease. Now, Jesus, we've had just about enough of this. Thank you very much. Quick, push him off the cliff before he says even something more stupid. Now, I don't usually wish to throw people off of cliffs, But when I do, they usually have it coming to them. And we got to admit, Jesus kind of had it coming. I mean, he knew good and well that what he was saying was going to be antagonizing. But he said it anyway. But then Luke tells us that he escapes. He passed through the midst of them and went on his way. Actually, the most faithful translations of this line say that he goes through the middle of them. Jesus doesn't buy any of these binary divisions that they've been carving out for themselves. He's not pro-Jew or anti-Samaritan. He's not pro-Nazareth or anti-Syrian. He's not Presbyterian or Lutheran or Episcopalian or Catholic or, God forbid, even Baptist. Jesus isn't Republican or Democrat. He doesn't favor male or female, Gamecock nor Tiger, Tar Heel nor Blue Devil. Jesus won't be contained in their divisions. Rather, Jesus passes through the middle. And yet Jesus is still with them and with us in the midst of us. Now, in those times that we find ourselves on the wrong side of the dividing line, and inevitably we're all going to find ourselves there, it seems like Jesus is the one who intentionally crosses that line as well. And it's not just because Jesus wants to be a rule breaker or a rebel. Jesus crosses those lines that people draw just to be with the people on the other side of that line. Now, obviously, the causes and the groups with whom we associate ourselves are very important. And frequently, they are God-ordained. And that is often going to put us into opposing positions against some others. Sometimes even others within our own church family. So how do we know how to handle these divisions when they inevitably occur? Well, here's an idea. Why don't we look to that other scripture passage that we read today to serve as a guide? If I can comprehend all mysteries and all knowledge, or if I have faith great enough to move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away everything I own to feed the poor, to feed those poorer than I, then hand over my body to be burned, but I do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, love is not jealous, it doesn't put on airs, it is not snobbish, it is never rude or self-seeking, it is not prone to anger, nor does it brood over injuries. Love doesn't rejoice in what is wrong, but rejoices in the truth. There is no limit to love's forbearance, to its true trust, its hope, its power to endure. Love never fails. So in love, Jesus crossed all these lines and these barriers that people built up. In love, we too can pass through the middle of divisions that seem ever present all around us. In love, we can make our convictions known and advocate for the rights, justifiably, of others, but do so without demonizing or demoralizing those with whom we differ. remember, before they got distracted with all the divisions and wanting to maintain their sense of superiority, the people of Nazareth were thrilled to hear that the scriptures were being fulfilled in their hearing. Fulfilled through the epiphany of Christ among them. And we too, we can still be thrilled that the scriptures are fulfilled in our hearing. Fulfilled through the everyday epiphanies that we experience. Of Christ passing through the middle of us. Of Christ in the midst of us. Of us being Christ incarnate for others. Thanks be to God.
Friends, let us love not only in our words, but also in our deeds, through the tithes and offerings that we give today.
O God, bless these gifts that we have given as expressions of our love for you and our neighbors, that they may bring closer to fulfillment your reign
on peace and love.
Through Jesus Christ, our Sovereign. Amen.
So Jesus didn't pull any punches, especially when it dealt with justice and showing love for others. But he always did it in love, and so should we. So if you have found this to be a place that you'd like to share that kind of love and honesty with others, I invite you to join us this morning as we sing this hymn.
Thank you.
new birth and babies in the congregation, we also acknowledge one who has heard the calling in the night to go to Florence. Robin Permenter, please come up here. Robin has decided that this is the time that she should be moving to Florence, which is where her mother lives, and Dylan, her son's going to be going with her, and we are going to miss her greatly. But we do have the opportunity to bless her and pray for her on her journey. Robin, we give thanks for the gifts, talents, and love that you have shared in your days with us. May the lessons and the love that you've experienced here carry you on your journey forward. And may you learn new lessons and love that you can share with others. Congregation, do you pledge to remember and to pray for Robin in her journey ahead? The appropriate answer is, I will. We will. Robin, will you remember us and pray for us?
I will.
Bless you, Robin. And now, as we all go forward, may the beauty of God be reflected in our eyes, the love of God be reflected in our hands, the wisdom of God reflected in our words, and the knowledge of God flow from our hearts so that all might see, and in seeing, believe.